You may love those who are lovely, but to love your enemy, whoa, that does not come from me. That has to be the fruit of the Spirit, to unconditionally sacrifice yourself for his or her benefit. Now that is supernatural. Now that does not mean that as Christians we are passive, there's nothing we need to do. No, because you must remember how Paul has been speaking about walking by the Spirit, and as we have read, keep in step with the Spirit. So that is what we need to do, to connect with the Spirit by trusting and obeying. But as we do so, then he produces a fruit of love in our lives. And that is amazing, isn't it? That in you, each and every one of us who is a Christian, we have all the potential and power to live a life that is beautiful. Many of you would be familiar with Salvation Army, and you will see them in action, particularly at the end of the year during Christmas time. You would also think about Salvation Army centers when you are going to maybe want to bless others with your secondhand goods that are still serviceable. Salvation Army is a Christian organization. It started many years ago by General William Booth, and there was one convention he was supposed to turn up at, but was unable to do so. Instead, he wrote a simple letter. It read, "To the delegates of the Salvation Army Convention, my fellow comrades," in other words, just one word, "others." Signed, General William Booth. His point is succinct, but clear. The reason why Salvation Army exists is for others. It's a setup, it's an organization, a community that seeks to serve others with love. This is, I think, what Paul has been talking about since we've started this in Galatians 5, verse 13. Jesus gives us the freedom from sin and from our own self-righteous works. He reminds us that we are to use this freedom not to indulge in the desires of the flesh, but to use this freedom to serve one another in love. So remember this journey we took from verse 13, serve one another in love, because the church at that point of time was not doing so. They were biting and devouring one another. And so Paul says the only solution is if you walk by the Spirit, then you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. And when you walk in such love, you will not be under the law, you will not be under the condemnation of the law, because this love is the fulfilling of the law. Instead, the works of the flesh are evident. You have those sexual sins, superstitious sins, social sins, and sensual sins. And those who practice habitually these sins will not inherit the kingdom of God. But in a genius masterstroke, Paul now brings this with a chiastic structure. In other words, a mirror image, because he goes on in verse 22 onwards to say, the fruit of the Spirit is love, which is a contrast with the works of the flesh. He talks about how that there is no condemnation when someone walks in love. Against such things, there is no law. No law can condemn a life of love. And this is a parallel with you are not under the law. He says those who are Christ's, those who turn from sin to believe in Jesus Christ have made a decisive cut and break from sin. So they have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires, and that is a beautiful correspondence with verse 16. He says, you are now decisively cut off from sin, so be sure to keep in step with the Spirit, which is, again, a parallel with walk by the Spirit. You guys bite and devour one another, and so it is fitting that he says in verse 26, do not be conceited, provoking, envying one another. And now we end with looking at through love, serve one another. You can see in chapter 6, verse 1, all the way to verse 10, it is what it looks like to lovingly serve one another. So the Apostle Paul is not giving us abstract truths only. He is concretizing what it means to love and serve one another in verses 1 to 10 of chapter 6. Now, we're going to see how that involves restoring a brother who has fallen into sin, how that involves supporting those who are teaching God's word, and also involves doing good to everyone, especially to those who are of the household of faith. But all that, verse 1 to 10, is about lovingly serving one another. So, we're going to look at verse 1 to 5 this morning. We're not going to go all the way to verse 10. And verse 1 introduces to us the main verse of verse 1 to 5. Brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. So we're going to look simply at restoring a brother this morning. Now, before I go further, I'd like to say that Christian living involves community living. It's a very simple aspect that we need to be aware of, because so many of us assume that true spirituality is seen with how long you stay in a cave. It's the Chinese mindset of bi guan xiu lian. You know, hide in a cave, you master your kung fu, then you become a superstar there. We think Christianity is best seen when we are in the solitude. Now, there is a need for us to spend time alone with God. I'm not saying that is not true. But if your sum total of your Christian life is only based on how much of the Bible I've read, how much I've prayed, but it is with no connections or relations with gospel community, I think you have missed the point. Paul is very clear in Galatians 5. Jesus has set us free, and not just for us to stay in a cave, read our Bibles and pray. That is necessary, but it is also imperative, it's important, it's vital that we live out our Christian lives in community, in how we love and serve one another. So even before I go on, I want to ask you, where is your community? Well, you say, this is the community. I'm in the community. I say, yes, you are in a service, but I don't think this ought to be your community. I don't think this is where you really live out the Christian life, because this is not where you sit in circles. This is where you sit in rows. You face the front. You hear what's going on here, but you're not really doing anything with someone beside you. In fact, you may be irritated by the person beside you. His arm so long, his arm so big, or whatever. Well, Christian community is in circles, in how we do one another's. So you have to think for yourself, where do you live out your Christianity? So let's look at restoring a brother in particular. First, there are three things I'd like us to share, to know, as usual. The first thing is to look at the ministry of restoration. Paul says, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, the problem here is that someone is caught. The word in the Greek refers to someone who is caught off guard or caught by surprise. And then the next word of interest is the word transgression. And the word there refers to someone who has made a misstep, a blunder. So these two words combined convey the idea that someone has now fallen into some kind of sin. Freshly, if I may say. To contrast it with Galatians 5:21, referring to someone who is habitually practicing such sins. So, of course, I think someone who is habitually in sin should also be helped, but the idea here is catch that person who has fallen early, if possible. So if you see someone caught in a blunder, what should you do? Well, you should seek to restore him. The word restore in the Greek refers to being healing or mending someone. It is a word that is used for broken nets. Now, you fish with nets, but if the net is broken, it is useless, isn't it? All the fish will leak out or swim out. So this word restore is to mend that net, or it is also used to refer to someone who has a fracture. He's in pain and he can't use that limb, so you got to mend that limb. You got to mend that fracture. So how does a Christian mend or heal another broken Christian? Well, the word restore is the principle, but how do we do it? I think you got to look elsewhere in the Bible. For example, it might require some of us rebuking and warning the person in sin. We read about how Proverbs 27 says, better is an open rebuke than hidden love. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. So to help someone in sin, you might have to inflict some kind of pain. Have you seen people reduce fractures? What do you mean by reduce fracture? It means when it's broken, it's out of line. You got to bring it back into alignment. And oftentimes what you do is that, quite terror, the hand is broken and the other two persons will be needed to pull the two parts. Why? So that you can pull it and then hopefully you release a bit, it will join back in the same alignment. Now let me ask you, is pulling painless or painful? Oh, very painful. But it is necessary so that the bone will be set back again. Imagine in old times, don't have anesthesia, you know. Today we have, but in old times don't have. But my point is, restoring someone can be painful for the person. It's painful to be told that I'm sinning. It's painful to be told that I should stop. But that is sometimes what is needed. Or perhaps we think about Jesus and his words. If your brother sins against you, so he has committed some sin against you, then you are to go and tell him his fault. So don't go to your pastor first. You may need to eventually if it's a serious sin. But Matthew, according to Jesus, is saying, you go to him first. And you go to him not because you want to get even, not because you want him to say sorry so that you feel good. You go to him because you want to gain your brother, because you want to help him. So you go to tell him privately. So restore him in a spirit of gentleness. It involves sometimes a painful confrontation. It may involve a listening ear. It may involve a season of reading the Bible and praying together, but you do whatever it takes to help him be mended up again. Not fractured, not broken, not in pain of sin, but useful once more for the kingdom. That should be your desire. Now, who should be the one to do this restoration? Most church members will say, that's what the pastor is for. That's what we pay money for. Well, the Bible makes it clear, it's not necessarily the job of the pastor, but it's for those who are spiritual. Now, when you think about the word spiritual, you immediately think about miracle workers. You immediately think about some spiritual elites, mystics. Well, I don't think that's the way we should understand the word spiritual in a Greek pneumatikos, or those of the Spirit or with the Spirit. I think it should refer to what Paul has been speaking about prior to this. Verse 16 in chapter 5, those who walk by the Spirit, those who are led by the Spirit, and those who keep in step with the Spirit. So if you're someone walking by the Spirit, led by the Spirit, keeping in step with the Spirit, and you see another brother broken and hurting in sin, your responsibility is to go to restore him or her. To speak a word of kindness, a word of rebuke, to offer a listening ear, to be willing to give time, to read the scriptures and pray together so that he may be healed. This is our job. I'd like you to do something. I'd like you to look at each other and say to each other, I will fall someday. And it is true, myself included. Number two, I'd like you to say to each other, please help restore me when I do. And this is the only time you do the one another's in a service, all right? And then lastly, I need you, you need me, we need one another. Now, I'm thankful in our church, we have 50% of our people in care groups. Roughly there. Probably quite an accurate figure. Not counting the youth, not counting the young adults or the varsity group. We have about 50% of our people in community groups, in care groups. Not counting also discipleship groups. So quite a good, healthy number. But that also means that there is a good half of you who may not. You're not in any community. You are in a service, but you're not in circles. There is no way, if you're not in circles, to do the one another's. You will not be able to help yourself if you say, I'll fall someday, and there's no one to know my life and to come into my life, to speak truth into my life. You see, Christianity cannot be lived on your own. That's not God's design. God's design is that we are healthily provided for and we serve one another in the body of Christ. That's where you live out your worship. That's where you can obey Paul's words, serve one another in love. I'd like you to really think about your community life as a Christian. But let's move on. Paul mentions not only the ministry of restoration, he also talks about the manner of restoration. How are we to do it? We know what it is now. How are we to conduct this restoration? He says it very simply by pointing out, restore him in a spirit of gentleness. Be gentle about it. Now, I know when we think about gentle, we think about someone who is very soft. We think about someone who is maybe not so firm. We think about someone who is maybe a little bit like a softy. Well, I hope those are not the words you will immediately think about, because the word gentleness really has a meaning of not just being soft or easily stepped on, but it's an idea of strength under control. Someone who has strength under control. So you help others, and you should be gentle. You should not be explosive because you are out of control. You can be firm. You can be severe, but it's always strength under control. So I don't think this is telling us that when we correct someone, it's always got to be very soft and you cannot speak loudly. Well, there may be times you may need to do so, but remember, it's always strength under control. Now, when I think about gentleness, I think about Simon Cowell. Not really in an exact way, but you know how he is. He is quite harsh with his comments on these talent shows, American Idol or I think X Factor. He would say things like, worst singer in the world. He does not hold his punches. In fact, he said, if you lived 2,000 years ago and sang like that, they would have stoned you. Or, that was absolutely ghastly. I can honestly say, if you want, it will be the end of the American music industry. Now, he is very harsh with his words, but he actually has a good intention behind it. He said, harshness to me, if you say I'm harsh, I want you to know what real harshness is. Harshness to me is giving somebody false hopes and not following through. That is harsh. So he doesn't want people to imagine that they are good when they are not. So he gives them as it is. That's why he makes it so harsh. All right? Telling some guy or some girl who've got zero talent that they have zero talent actually is kindness. Now, I understand his intent, right? He doesn't want someone to waste time when he has zero talent. I understand his intent, but the way he goes about doing it is not what Paul would have recommended, I think. So Paul recommends that we help people, but we help them also with a spirit of gentleness. I think the idea may correspond to what he said elsewhere, speaking the truth in love. So we need to give people truth, but we need to give it in the best way possible, in a loving way, so that the recipient understands very clearly why some things are being said. It's not because you don't like me, it's not because you're irritated by me, but because you love me. I think Paul also says, let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt. It's something that is pleasant, palatable. That's what we need to aim at. And Paul also spoke to Timothy, saying, the Lord's servant, i.e., you as a pastor, must not be quarrelsome, but kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. You will have opponents, but it doesn't give you the right to blast at them. But you correct them with gentleness. Why? Because God may perhaps grant them repentance leading to a knowledge of the truth. Paul is saying you can rebuke someone with gentleness and not abusiveness because ultimately you trust that it is God who convinces them anyway. So I think it brings us to an understanding that when we are supposed to restore someone, we don't have to do it in a harsh or mean or aggressive way. We can be controlled. We can be gentle. Now, let me ask you, who can be gentle? You say the ladies are. Well, I think so. Ladies are generally, I guess, more gentle in a sense. But Paul here tells us we are to do it in the spirit of gentleness, and you must not forget, just a few verses earlier, he told us that it is the fruit of the Spirit, love, that bears the characteristic of gentleness. So really, it makes full sense, great sense, that the ones who are spiritual are those who are walking, being led, and keeping in step with the Spirit. They will be the ones who will bear that fruit of love, and they will be the ones who would be able to restore in a spirit of gentleness. All right? So, that's what Paul is saying here. And then he adds on, keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. So, he is warning them that when you correct someone, you may also someday fall into that sin. So, be warned so that you are not going to be conceited or censorious when you correct someone. Because you know you are equally vulnerable to sin as well. I think this is very similar to how Jesus said that you should not be judgmental towards others in Matthew 7. Jesus said, why do you judge people in such a way that you see this tiny speck in your eye, but you ignore the log in your own eye? Remember that humorous example? And so he says, when you want to help others, when you want to restore others, be sure that you first take the log out of your own eye. Then you will see clearly to take the speck out of your brother's eye. Ridiculous picture. One big log in your eye, and you're saying, I want to help you take out the speck in your eye. You're a hypocrite when you are judging people in a censorious or critical way. Now, I have been in a demonstration mood in the past 4 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks. So today, let me keep that streak going. Can I have a volunteer, please? All right, come, Michelle. Well, last, I think 2-3 weeks ago was your husband. Now you follow your husband. Wonderful. Let's give her a round of applause. Is her eye very precious to you? No, I'm kidding. All right, I have a pen here. I'm not going to poke you. But I like you, you're right-handed. Okay, I like you to stretch forth your left hand. All right, and with your finger, try to point to it. That's all. All right, point to it, back. Revolve, yeah, and then point to it again. Okay, see her speed, all right? Try. Not bad. Again? Okay, she's got the hang of it. Not bad, right? Okay. If she's not so good, you all come lah. All right, now I'd like you to cover your right eye, okay? And do now the same thing. A bit lousy now, ah. Again? Okay, now you can uncover and try again. Okay, a lot better. A lot better. All right, let's give her a round of applause. She was missing it quite a bit when one of her eye is covered. You see that? Have you ever wondered why God made you with two eyes? Why? Because one eye degree not so good, the other eye can make up with it. No, there's a reason why you have two eyes. Why? Two eyes are needed for? Depth of perception, correct. So if you have one eye, you can see. But you can't perceive distance and depth so well. You need two eyes to give you that stereotactic vision, to perceive depth. One eye, you can't see clearly, you can't do things very well. If you're a surgeon, with one eye, if you see a surgeon is like that, you better. Because supposed to poke a bit further than you jialat, right? So we need two eyes. And I think this is an interesting illustration. It's one eye that has the lock, so the other eye still can see. But you can't see so clearly, and you can't help the person so well. So take out that prejudice, that bias, that pride in your eye, that sin in your eye, then you can see clearly. So I think that's a similar idea, possibly, that Paul is warning against. If you are arrogant and proud and censorious, you will not be able to help someone. Do it in a spirit of gentleness, and to encourage that spirit of gentleness, think about your own self. So don't be too harsh with one another. I think that is the manner with which we are to restore one another. Finally, I'd like us to look at the motivation of restoration. Why should we do what we do? Why can't I just ignore the person? Why can't I just say, "Aiya, forget it lah, swa lah"? You know how it is? We can easily just say, "It's not my business anyway." Why would we want to spend time praying, helping, journeying with someone in sin? Why would we risk our reputation? Why would we risk being disliked on someone else? The simple answer, according to Paul, is love. That's it. You've got to understand the logic we have been following so far. Chapter 5, verse 6, Paul has been saying that what matters for the child of God, for the follower of Jesus Christ, is not whether you are circumcised or not. That's not important, because you're not justified by circumcision or not. But you're justified, you are God's child, based on faith. Remember, a man is justified not by the works of the law, but by faith in Jesus Christ. And this faith is not going to be quiet or fruitless. This faith will and must evidence itself through love. So Paul is saying real Christian living manifests love, which is, in my own definition, a sacrifice of yourself for the benefit of others. You will do that if you really have genuine faith. He repeats that, as we have seen in verse 13, you should use this freedom in Christ to serve one another in love. And he reminds us of the great commandment Jesus gave, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. So this restoring of one another is a necessary reflection of loving service. So why do we do what we do? Simple answer, love. And it is in that context that we can then make sense of this very unique phrase, the law of Christ. It's only when you restore your brother, it's only when you bear one another's burdens that you really fulfill the law of Christ. What is the law of Christ? It's love. It's a unique phrase. It happens only here in the Bible. There's a similar quite close statement in 1 Corinthians 9, but not exactly like this. The law of Christ, unique here, I think refers to the principle of love by which we are to operate. Love is described to be the law of Christ. Why? Because it is all because of Jesus. He's reminding us that a capacity and a desire and a power to love comes from Christ. We love because in Christ we find our motivation. Christ died for me. He loved me. And now I'm to love Him by loving His people. So we love with Christ as our motivation. That's why love is called the law of Christ. Perhaps another way of looking at this is that we love with Christ not only as our motivation, but also as our model. So love is the law of Christ because Christ supremely exemplified love for us. Or thirdly, another possibility is that we love with Christ as our might. He's the person in us that is able to bring out love. Love did not come from me. It's the Spirit of Christ who produces this fruit of love. So we love because Christ is the one who lives His life through us. So if I may say, the law of Christ is love, and it's called the law of Christ because Christ is our motivation, our model, our might, or we love because of Christ, we love like Christ, and we love through Christ. And if this is still not enough, a fourth possibility, maybe Christ is our message. By this shall all men know we are your disciples if we love one another. So when we love one another, people know we belong to Jesus, and that's why it's also called the law of Christ. Now, what is the idea Paul had when he talks about the law of Christ? Any of these M's? Maybe one, maybe two, maybe three, maybe four, I do not know, but I think they are all plausible considerations. So he says, this responsibility is born out of love. So we carry one another's burdens. The word here refers to a heavy, heavy weight. Now, just a little technical point here. There are some who think that the word burdens here would involve things like emotional, physical, financial burdens that brothers and sisters may have. So we have to help one another there. Now, I think Christians should help one another regardless of the burdens they bear. But I don't think that is what Paul is referring to here. Why? Because I read this in conjunction with verse 1. And verse 1's context is about someone who has fallen into some sin. So now you bear that burden. Help him out of sin. So there are other verses in the Bible that will teach us to love and help one another in all their various problems. For example, 5:13 will be good. Serve one another in love. Or later on, we are going to read 6:10, do good to all, especially those who are of the household of faith. So helping one another is true. It is the truth, but it's not the truth of this text. That's all. I hope that's clear. And then he goes on to say bear. The word bear is to lift up, to carry. And it is in the imperative in the Greek, which means it's a command. So Paul commands us to do this. Why? Because it's not easy. It's not easy to help someone who has fallen into sin. Let me say this. It's not easy to tell someone he has fallen into sin, isn't it? We are Asians, except for some of you. Most of us are Asians. And Asians, we tend to be a little bit more reserved. We don't like to be too confrontational. I'm someone like that. I don't like to confront people. I like to be Mr. Nice Guy, you know. Because I think my idol, possibly, could be the approval of men. So if I tell you something you don't like to hear, you may dislike me, and that makes it difficult for me to start that conversation in the first place. But you see, I have to do it whether I'm Asian or whether I like it or not, because this is a command. This is what it means to love one another. I recall a conversation I had with a brother. It's a difficult one. And at the end of the conversation, he told me, "Why didn't you tell me this earlier? You didn't love me enough to tell me." And he's right. I knew something was wrong, but I didn't want to risk being disliked. I didn't want to face a difficult conversation, and therefore I didn't love him enough to tell him. But Paul says we are to carry this load, even if it is difficult. We are to serve one another. This is not telling someone outside the church. This is talking about someone within the gospel community, the church, the brothers. We can't say it's not my business. We can't say with Cain, "Am I my brother's keeper?" No, we are called to love one another. That is the evidence of the Christian. I'm sure you know that when you discipline your kids, it's not easy. It's not pleasant, but you do it, and that's all because you love your kids, isn't it? So, this is how we are to do it. And Paul goes on to say, if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. What is he saying here? I think what Paul is saying is, there may be some who say, "I don't need to help that brother because I am quite spiritual already." He may say to himself, "I'm already circumcised. I keep the festivals. I'm something." Paul says, when you think you're something because of all these external things, and you do not love, and you do not serve, and you do not restore, you do not bear burdens, then you're nothing. Just as he said in other passages, without love, even if you could speak in tongues and move mountains and give your body and do not love, you are nothing. So Paul here is saying, don't pride yourself in all those things that you pride yourself in. If you do not love, you are nothing. You're just deceiving yourself. Instead, let each one of you test or examine his own work. Check your life. Where is your reason for boasting? In the context here, I think is, where are the works of love? Now, the works of love are not what you do to save yourself, but the works of love are what you do as an evidence of true faith in Jesus Christ. On that final day, we will all stand before God, and what would be your boast? Would it be that I was circumcised? Would it be that I attended church services? Would it be that I read the Bible? Or would it be that I loved God? I fed the poor. I gave a cup of water. I visited your people in jail, as Jesus would have said in the parable of the goats and the sheep. I loved. Then his reason to boast will be in himself alone. He would be able to say, "Lord, these are, by your grace, the works of love." And he will not be boasting that he is better than the other person. He did not kill like Saddam Hussein or Hitler and pride himself there. You know how it is when your kids come back home with the exam results. They will not show you the paper first. They'll first tell you, they'll prep you mentally. "What, the paper very hard? My teacher also say very hard." Every time like that one. "Very difficult. My friend, 47 out of 100. "Well, the other guy, 52 out of 100. But I got 66. Well, his pride is that he boasts in his neighbor. "I'm better than my neighbor." Well, what matters is not how you do with regards to your neighbor, it's how you do with regards to yourself. And so on that final day of judgment, it will not be, "Oh, I was better than Adolf Hitler." It will be, "Where are the works of love?" So each one of us will have to bear our own load. The word load here is a different word from the burdens in verse 2. It refers to a small backpack. It probably refers to our own personal responsibility to love. So verse 2 is about the heaviness we are to share in. Verse 5, the word Lord, is about the personal responsibility with regards to love. So, in a nutshell, the church at Galatia is struggling because of legalism, and they are also struggling because there's a lot of infighting. They are biting and devouring one another to the degree that the church is in danger of implosion. So Paul says, walk by the Spirit, be led by the Spirit, keep in step with the Spirit. Because only then will you be able to manifest the fruit of the Spirit. And when you have this love, this gentleness, then make sure you restore one another. I need you, you need me, we need one another. And instead of tearing the church up, we build the church up. That's Paul's desire and design for the church in Galatia. I think this is a sermon that may be helpful for you to discuss in your care groups. I think if you're in community, this is a great time for you to maybe reorientate yourself to why we exist in the first place in our care groups or discipleship groups or community groups. Maybe think for yourself in your CGs, discuss these things. What does it mean for me to live out my faith in gospel community? Am I doing it? Or is my community my wife and I? Can lah. Strictly speaking, also community lah. But I think Paul's desire is more than just your husband and wife lah. So where is my community? Is my community just turning up on Sunday, sitting in a row, or is there someone, a group of people that I am accountable for and accountable to, where they can speak into my life and when I can also serve them in their lives? Think about that for yourself. This is a relevant question for at least 50% of our people. Number 2, how am I fulfilling the law of Christ? How am I living out the life of love? Christ as my motivation, my model, my might, and my message. Number 3, who can you restore today? For a long time, you have chucked that person's name aside and say, it's not my business. Well, no one is helping that person. Maybe it's me. We all have a part to play. Your pastor can't speak to so many people, he'll die. But we all have a part to play, and that's God's design. It's never a ministry of one. It's all of us. Number 4, what will be your boast on the final day of judgment? I was circumcised. I was baptized. I attended services. What will be your boast? And number 5, how can we encourage or help one another today? Let's bow for a word of prayer. I hope these are the questions you will think about for yourself. These are the things you'll talk about in your gatherings. And so I pray that today we will think about the Word of God and not just hear a sermon, but by God's grace, live our lives to better fulfill His will. I pray that we will be a church that actively, not just live quietly, but we will be a church that actively builds one another up and keeps one another away from sin. And if you're here with us for the first time, I want to say to you, just as Christians are to love one another, more importantly, our love for one another flows from how God has first loved us. The great message of the Bible is love. That while you are yet a sinner, Jesus died for you on the cross. He came not to be served, He came to serve. He came to give His life to pay for your sins. I hope today you will not just come to church, you will not just ask to be baptized, you will believe in Jesus by faith. So, dear God, bless your word to all our hearts. May we, as a church, love one another, and may sinners believe in your love and your Son. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.